Urban Today, brought to you by
Metropolitan International University. We offer postgraduate diplomas, bachelor's degree, diploma, certificate programs, weekend, day and evening. Registrations in progress at our campuses.
It's a very good morning once again, and thanks very much for joining us on Urban Today. My name is Henry Sekanjako, welcoming you to this segment, Kachai. And as you know, we're still in the election mood. We started off on Jan 14th with the presidential and parliamentary elections, and the electoral process is still going on. Tomorrow we'll be going to the polls once again to vote for the LNC three leaders across the country. And of course, it has not been an easy process. So we've seen quite a number of things happening. And of course, today we want to be speaking, this morning we want to be talking about the aftermath of the January 14th elections, and then the election that we have had so far. And of course, to discuss this, I've been joined by Sarah Bileti, who is the ED, the Center for Constitutional Governance. And also I've been joined by Mr. Talbert Musinguzi, who is the Wakiso District returning officer. We're expecting Richard Nsube, who is the deputy spokesperson, Electoral Commission. And of course, we'll be talking about the electoral process, the aftermath. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
So thanks for joining us on Urban Today.
Thank you, and good morning, viewers.
All right. Mr. Musinguzi, I'll start with you. Tell us, how have you seen the electoral process that that is about to come to an end? Tomorrow we'll be voting for the LOC three, councillors or chairpersons across the country. So I want to pick your mind on how you have seen the entire process. How's it been for you?
True. Thank you very much. And good morning, viewers of Urban TV. Tomorrow we are going to the polls again. Mm-hmm. It's the last phase now. We are at the local government level.
Yeah.
We are going to elect LC3 chairpersons and their councillors for sub-county, town, and municipal divisions. It's an adult suffrage election, secret ballot, and we are at our polling stations, the ones we have been using for all the general elections we have been holding.
Yeah.
Starting 7 a.m. in the morning, that's when we open our polling stations. Then close the polling stations at 4, mm-hmm. but polling continues until the last voter, the line, because his or her ballot.
Mm.
So that's the process we are in now. The materials are already distributed to the districts, the entire country,
mm-hmm.
and the distribution to our holding centers, that is usually the sub-counties, starts today. And the purpose is to ensure that we are at our polling stations by 7, so that there are no delays. All factors remain constant. There are no rains or anything. We should be able to open all our polling stations by 7 in the morning of tomorrow.
Talk to us about the entire process. How have you seen it?
It has moved on well. It has moved on well from the presidential election on 14th. Actually, we had started on 11th with elections of 6. At sub-county level, the councillors.
Yeah.
From there, we moved to the 14th, where we had presidential and parliamentary. It also moved on well. All returns have been submitted to the commission.
Mm.
And from there, we moved on to the 20th, then the 25th. Now we are on the 3rd. We also had the 27th. Actually, yesterday, we had elections for youth, for the regional MPs across the country in the different regions. And it's moving on well. Moving on well.
Thank you. Sarah, to you. You've been observing, the electoral process. You said we started off on 11th of January. And tomorrow we'll be, having the last phase. How do you rate their performance? What have you observed?
Well, we started observing elections in September.
Okay.
Because elections is not an event. It's a process.
Mm-hmm.
So we observed the process leading to nomination, the nomination process, the campaign process, the voting process, which is ending tomorrow.
Mm.
We have teams that have been observing youth elections, which were largely peaceful,
mm-hmm.
save for an incident in Mubende, where candidates were complaining that they were not given registered nomination as provided by law. But away from that, we witnessed the a violent nomination exercise where two presidential candidates were arrested on nomination, brutalized. I think that is something really that has never happened in this country. We witnessed a violent campaign trail. If you take an example of the FDC candidate, Honorable Muriat, he was tear gassed 43 times while going for official campaign rallies, gazetted by Electoral Commission. We witnessed the disruption of campaigns for opposition. I think the only, even Mr. Katumba and the, I think the only person who was not disrupted in the campaign trail was the lady candidate, Nancy Kalembe. The rest of the opposition candidates were disrupted while going for campaigns. Agents arrested, brutalized. And of course the violence that happened on 18th and 19th of November was very unfortunate after the arrest of Honorable Chagrani. And then voting day, I wouldn't call voting day peaceful because, you know, peace goes beyond the absence of violence. In Kampala and Wakiso, where I was observing personally, we all know the military deployment, the presence of armed people. I think you could not walk 5 minutes in Kampala without meeting a patrol team of about 25 to 30 armed people. I wouldn't call that peace. Because if that is what peace looks like, then I don't want that peace. So we had an election, really, that was an armed election, especially in the cities. So that, and then voting day, our colleagues, as a part of the observer teams, were arrested at Africana. Immediately after issuing our preliminary statement on the opening of voting countrywide, the police seized the press. About 30 police officers moved into Africana, went and seized the data center, where people were coordinating with observers in the field because of the internet shutdown. You know, you were doing analog coordination of making calls, writing, typing. So those 26 data clerks were arrested together with two CSO leaders. So, and then at the tele center, we kept seeing journalists asking for how results were coming in. Nobody could see results as earlier promised, as earlier provided for, that the transmission centers would be transparent, would be open, everybody would see, but there was nothing to see. And as I conclude briefly on that tarring of results, Section 56 of the, I know there's a petition, I haven't seen the petition, and I don't want to be caught between discussing matters that are for determination in court, which leads to sub judice. But Section 56 of the Presidential Elections Act provides that every district returning office, and I am glad we have the returning office of Wakiso, will transmit full district results. But I think for Wakiso, we were told on voting day, results for 61 polling stations were not available. So did you transmit partial results contrary to the law? So this is briefly really the things that we have been observing.
Mr. Msinguzi, you have heard Sarah's submission. She's talking about the campaign, you know, was, you know, largely violent, the campaign trail. We saw the rest of different polling agents for different candidates. She has talked about the military deployment and also the sieging of, you know, that data collection center. What is your take on her submission?
On the issue of violence, you know, we carried out elections in challenging times of COVID.
Sure.
and we had to operate within the guidelines as set by the Ministry of Health. And the Electoral Commission issued out these guidelines at the time of nomination to all the candidates that yes, we are going to do campaigns, but we are going to have what they termed scientific campaigns, in that we are not going to have mass rallies so that we don't congregate so many people.
Yep.
We are going to use the media, we are going to use the radio stations, we want to go virtual to avoid congregating people. So most of the reports about violence were as a result of some of the candidates trying to argue in action against some of these guidelines. And that is an area that was handled by security, and now they were handling their thing. Now, the arrest of agents, again, it is security, you know, they had information that maybe they wanted to verify. I know Madam Villette might be having maybe some few issues in either court or at police in regard to these actions. I will go to where, as Electoral Commission, she's results transmission at the tally center. Results were transmitted electronically from all districts to the tally center. And we had a display screen at the tally center that was showing what was coming in. Every time a district submitted, the results would be announced on screen. Us in the districts, we announced verbally. But this time, the Electoral Commission added also that announcement on screen. So we had what we are telling. We would inform the agents and the candidates that have received this. They would still corroborate it with what they are seeing on screen. And it's the same that happened at the National Tally Center. Transmission was full, because that law says there must be full transmission. The report of 61 missing from.
So maybe the question is who witnessed the transmission, because the complaint that you also came up with from the East African Community Observers and the African Union Observer, they were not able to witness the transmission of results. How was it done?
At the National
Tally Center. We are not talking of the district, National Tally Center.
How was it done?
It was the same process.
But the observers could not say anything, and journalists, what are you talking about?
Because we had screens
that were at the National.
No, I was at my district.
Okay, then I think you're better off speaking of the district, but don't say things that were not.
At the National Tally Center,
yes, please.
I observed there.
You were there?
Yes.
So you
checked there before going to the Tally Center. Yes, I'm abreast of what took place there.
Sure.
And true. So it was the same system.
Maybe you can share with us what exactly
happened. It was the same system, because the transmission for us, even the districts, to confirm that you have transmitted, you had to be accessed at the National Tally Center. And accessibility was not hidden.
Okay.
It would be a display that this district has come in.
So how come people who were there could not see?
So were there restrictions, Mr. Musinguzi, that so and so should access, you know? How was it done? Were there restrictions, really?
Or at the National Tally Center?
Yes, on
that
who should,
so should be accessed.
Because according to Ms. Birej, she's saying that it was not, you know, no one witnessed it. And then you're
and the telling reports, us
that
the observer know,
it
reports,
was people able to witness that.
It's not true.
The journalists, because for us, it may be important to note also is that the civil society organizations, we were denied tags to go to the National Tally Center. But we were watching TV, because after internet shutdown, we all had one channel of seeing what was happening in Chambogo.
Yeah.
Two journalists, I think three, on three occasions, kept asking the chairman the results that he was announcing, and why he was not announcing per district as the law provides. Because the WAKSO returning office is saying he sent full results. But the chairman said he announced as the results came in and left out 61 polling stations from WAKSO, which were announced 2 weeks later. So and the returning office is saying otherwise. So which is which?
What caused that? What caused the delay in transmission of the results from
61
police station? polling stations and all those other things that happen.
You see, the process of transmission is like this. That as the system we had, as you entered is what would move. So are you talking of the final declaration or the process of transmission? Because transmission,
we don't wait.
That you are going to wait for a full district to first come in as us in the districts, okay, before you send it. No.
Mm.
As you receive, you are sending. And what we are saying, that is what Chairman was also reading as they were coming in, But the final tell the final declaration.
When did you send the final district results?
For
WAKSO.
For presidential?
Yes.
They were there by 15th. They were there.
Did you send that once?
No, we are sending as they are coming in.
Mm.
But by the time the chairman read the results, full results were there. The district was there.
Are you aware? Mm. Did you see the article of 61? And they were announced 2 weeks later. They were just announced recently by the chairman when he said, "I have finished tabulation."
Mm.
But even him, he was live saying, "I have now added the polling stations that were missing, including the one from WAKSO."
Maybe you can tell us, the people that are watching us, what causes the delay? Because one would think that WAKSO, being near Kampala, this result would even be the first to come in before we receive those ones from, you know, Karamoja, Napark, you know. What happens?
It's the number of polling stations that you have.
Mm.
It's the number of polling stations that you have. Because you might find a district with 100 polling stations, or 200.
Mm.
WAKSO, you have 1,434.
Okay.
Kampala is also in 1,434. 30-something also, it's in 1,000. So it depends on the number of polling stations that you have. It's not the distance. It is not physical that you carry and bring. If it was carrying and bringing, WAKSO would come, Kampala would be first, WAKSO next.
Mm.
But the electronic transmission is according to the number of polling stations that you have and how the time you take for you in the district to tally them and submit them.
Okay.
Mm.
Maybe one
but
last
we meet
question,
the 48 hours.
Allow me.
That is
since we are sure. privileged to be with the returning officer. Section 56 of the Presidential Elections Act is very clear on transmission. It says a district returning officer will transmit full results of a district. What was your basis of sending per polling station?
You see, the sending per polling station is not the full transmission as the law states. The full transmission is when I have sent the transmission receipt.
Tally sheet.
The tally sheet.
So why did you send partial? Why didn't you first finish? Like the law provides.
No. What we are saying, you see, it is not that you pile and send. This is an understanding as if you are carrying physically.
Okay.
The electronic transmission is that as you enter, because we are interconnected, the entire country, to the National Tally Center, as you enter the polling station you have received, it is accessed by the National Tally Center. The law looks at when you sign the final tally sheet of the result, saying now the district has come. That is when the law is applied, not when you are just entering and it is being accessed the other time, the other side of the National Tally Center. So that is the system. Now, when we say I have transmitted, that is at what time did you sign?
All right.
Okay, and maybe for the benefit of viewers,
I'm
sorry really to delay on this matter because I know two grounds in court, not going into the details since I've not seen the details. The Chairman, Electoral Commission, is expected to read results per district. Meaning that even if an electronic system is relaying as you read per polling station, the chairman is supposed to wait for the district form and say, WAKSO, Katumba has got this much, you know, Mayambara this much, yes. And that's why people were not comfortable at the Chambogo Tally Center. So since you're representing your institution, what do you think caused that? And maybe my last comment on the results is we have seen about 28 polling stations in WAKSO, where Chagrani scored zero. And on eight of these, Katumba scored all the votes. meaning that whoever voted on that polling station voted for only Katumba, and the rest of the candidates have zero. Eight. Did you witness this at your district?
Mr. Busuk, the floor is yours. You can, you know, give us some answers to that and what you think happened.
It is an election. So it's possible that the voters that turned up voted for that candidate.
Only. All of them.
It is possible.
And all of them turned up. No one fell sick in 1 year. No one died
that
in
is
1 year.
In what no one,
yes.
Eight polling stations?
Yes, 100% turn up. You know, voter registration happened in 2019. So what it means is that in these areas, from 2019 to 2021 January, nobody fell sick, nobody died, nobody moved to another area, nobody traveled.
There was 100%
In your district.
It's possible.
All right. Okay. So, Mr. Msimbi, you're saying it's possible, and you know, we cannot say no.
We can't kill people. Uh-huh. We can't force people to move when they have not moved.
Sure. I know.
So, it's possible.
Another issue that came up, Mr. Msimbi, you know, that we saw, especially in the local government elections, is a mix-up of party symbols, some names, you know, missing on the ballot papers. What exactly happened? And also the other issue is about staffing. How do these ballots end up in the hands of private individuals? Because we imagine they're supposed to be controlled by the Electoral Commission. So how do they end up in the hands of Ugandans?
I will start with one of the few areas of mixing up. It is possible it happens. You know, we have, and these are lessons learned every electoral cycle. The turn up of candidates nominated for the different electoral areas was really high. And secondly, this time we did demarcation of electoral areas, whereby with the number of electoral areas where people are contesting are also very many. So in the process of tabulating this data on the ballot papers, one, two symbols can be mixed up. But the commission has a remedy for that. When it usually happens, we set a residue election. And we're going to have it on the 8th, this month, which will be, I think, Monday. We're going to have residue elections for all those areas that couldn't conclude their election because of these few glitches here and there. Yes.
But how does it happen? Because I imagine Electoral Commission, before we go, you know, vote for voting, I imagine you do inspection, you look at these ballots, you see that, okay, this one has a mistake, the name is missing, maybe a symbol is missing, and then you recall it.
Yes, we do.
Don't you?
We do display, we do final verification, but issues, because it is done using computers and the rest, so it happens.
And that you, Sarah, what do you think
it is not an alarming percentage.
Okay. Atisa, what do you think, you know, the EC can do better to avoid, you know, this mistake? Because you have seen things like to do with ballot stuffing coming up year in, year out. What should be done to avoid this?
No, our electoral laws are very clear, although we still be pushing for other amendments. But I just wish Electoral Commission and the electoral officials could follow the law. Because the duty of making laws in this country is a preserve of parliament. What is expected of electoral officials is to conduct elections within the laws and regulations of the country. But they divert. They divert. There was an incident in Nansana where one of our observers, you know, was at the polling station, and about 200 LDUs were brought to vote. And they were not on the register. So when they asked the presiding officer and the chairman of the area who was also observing, and they said, why? Our hands are tied. Do you want us to die? So some of these things, I think the people who occupy these offices do a big disservice to Ugandans, a big disservice to this country. They are not up to the task. They are compromised. and they don't discharge their duties as expected of them.
Sure.
And this has been the problem of Uganda for 58 years.
Mm-hmm.
We are still struggling for more than 5 decades, close to 6 decades. We are still struggling with the basics of democracy
mm-hmm.
because of the selfishness and the incapabilities
mm.
of the people who occupy offices to do with elections.
Mm. Would you say Electoral Commission was in charge of this electoral process? Because we saw incidences where the military and the police, you know, were fully, you know, in charge. We saw President Shukandes being arrested. Chagulanyi was arrested in Kalangala district. We didn't see Electoral Commission coming up to condemn the act.
Mm.
So would you say EC was really fully in charge of the entire electoral process?
Yes, we're in charge.
To what extent?
Fully. You see, when an election is taking place, it does not mean that the country has come to stand still.
Mm-hmm.
That all other attendant laws, all other attendant restrictions have come to stand still. No.
Yeah.
No. Much as we're going to respect the electoral law, we must also be mindful of other existing laws. So if we are to look at the arrests, and let's analyze, are they related? What are they choosing this person of?
Mm.
That is where you can say, but they have said this person is moving within the parameters of your law, but the Electoral Commission are not coming out to say anything. No. Let's analyze it that way. We try to separate the two. Yes, you are a candidate. Yes, you are a client of the Electoral Commission. But what the other organs of government are choosing you of, is it related?
Mm.
Must you not pay your debt because you are a candidate? So if you are arrested at the nomination center by, say, people who are demanding you, should the Electoral Commission come in and say, don't take him because he's a candidate? So we should also analyze that one. Now, when it comes to our mandate as Electoral Commission, we are fully in charge.
What were the people arrested for, once again? If the returning officer can give us some examples. For example, nomination day, what were the offenses? Or these rallies that have been disrupted, what were the offenses?
Yeah, because candidate Chagulanyi has
what were the offenses?
That she was arrested after nomination.
Yes, on the nomination center.
Mm-hmm.
What was the offense?
Contradicting the COVID guidelines.
You know, if I may...
Because they were we said, the commission was very clear.
Mm.
And it issued out these guidelines to all the candidates. It said, yes, you're coming for nominations, but please don't carry crowds with you. A candidate, you are responsible for whatever happens in your camp. You are responsible for the conduct and the behavior of your supporters. So if you fail to prevail over your supporters, the issue is not electoral commission.
Mm.
It is you, the candidate. And now this is what I was saying, that the attendant laws which were existing were operating in COVID where they said we don't want crowds. So if the Minister of Health raises an alarm and says, but we have someone who is contradicting our guidelines, shouldn't the police move?
Did you see President Museveni's crowd as he was thanking voters? Did you see, even in your district, did you see it?
No, I didn't see that one.
Good. Did you see how NRM conducted primaries? Did they observe COVID guidelines?
Primaries were not in the mandate.
I know it is not. I'm asking as a citizen.
Mm.
Did you see NRM primaries? You were showing people voting on this TV.
Mm-hmm.
Did people follow COVID guidelines on voting day? You were showing crowds, people standing next to each other. In Tinda, there was even no provision of hand washing.
Mr. Nsingizu, these guidelines, were they being implemented selectively, the guidelines, the COVID guidelines?
On our part, no, as Electoral Commission. Because for us, whoever was coming to our functions, one, we're insisting, and the messages were very clear. You can check even everything we did. Please ensure you have your mask on. Please, whenever you reach our point, there should be hand washing. So if there was an incident like that, it needs to be followed up. But we had to ensure all polling stations have hand washing facilities.
Mm.
We even put a particular constable, a polling officer, in charge of SOPs to be in line with the Ministry of Health guidelines. So once someone contradicts some of these things, we are not immune, even when we're in elections.
Because we saw instances where the Electoral Commission was calling, summoning candidates. He summoned Chagulanyi, summoned Patrick Kamriat, of course, for violating the COVID-19 guidelines.
True.
And we saw the other side, NRM was only represented by the Secretary General. The candidate didn't come through. So Ugandans maybe think that this was not right. Maybe the President himself needed to also go and meet the commission.
Did the commission summon him, or they feared him?
They've summoned him, maybe. Some things you can tell us.
They feared, no. They summoned those. You can be represented by your agent or your campaign manager.
But representation of Honorable Kyagulanyi and Amuriat was refused, and they had to find the time and go.
Yes, because so? the summons for Kyagulanyi and Amuriat were for come in person.
That was their meeting. The president?
The meeting before, where the president sent a representative. That one said, please come and we meet. And those who sent agents, it was okay. But the last one was say, come in person. And that's
and
why we expected them to
I want to say something on COVID guidelines.
Please do.
You know, in Africa, Uganda is not the only country that has had elections during COVID. Ghana has just concluded a very successful election. That followed COVID guidelines. Other countries did hold, including Cameroon, including, you know, about seven countries have had presidential elections in Africa amidst COVID pandemic. So the deception by government agencies, as if Uganda is a special category when it comes to COVID guidelines and elections, and the justification of violence and brutality using COVID should be demystified. What these countries have done better than, of course, we don't expect, you know, a regime that cannot hold a normal election. You would not expect them to be organized. But I want to give an example of what should have happened. In other countries, COVID being a health pandemic and not a political pandemic, but in Uganda's case it is a political pandemic, the management of standard operating procedures of COVID during campaigns was in the hands of health officials, including the paramedicals at village level. This country has health teams up to village health team, parish health team, sub-county health team, county health team, and district health teams. So the ideal situation, but also it needs, you know, a well-intending government. The ideal situation would have been that the district medical officers, together with the health teams and paramedicals, are in charge of administration of SOPs, or standard operating procedures. If there is a rare, Electoral Commission has gazetted the press, that the health teams do their job. Because COVID is a health pandemic. But this country has taken advantage of COVID and used it as a political pandemic to harass opposition in this country.
Do you buy that opinion, Mr. Msingos?
No, it's our opinion. Mm-hmm. The opinion is different. That Uganda is different from these other countries, and our situation is different. So the way we handled it, how it was handled by the Minister of Health and the government, I think that was appropriate to us. And as yes, I agree with her that the structures on the ground, the health structures on the ground, should be in control in enforcing these guidelines. And as the Electoral Commission, we worked hand in hand with the district task force teams to ensure that the SOPs are more enforced. But we learn, and we're continuing to learn. COVID is something new, and we are learning more.
Yeah, because one would say that countries like US that have had elections, their cases are really quite high compared the ones for Uganda. Mm. And of course, he's saying that this was a political pandemic.
But the challenges of the US and COVID are different. Mm. The biggest challenge is climate. The second biggest challenge is demographics. So we cannot compare. Mm. Mm. And our advantage, Africa is only lucky on those two grounds, climate and demographics. There is no rocket science. Mm.
So the fact that our numbers are low, even as we come to the conclusion of the polling cycle, shows that the management has been effective.
Yeah. I think it's important to note, you know, yesterday during the youth elections, in Imbarara, in Guru, they were very organized. Other areas tried, but I think I would give Guru 100% in terms of organization, preparation, and prevention of COVID. Mm. Mbare Mubende did better. Mbarara put the elections in a hall in Intare. Mm. The crowding was for World Cup. You could think it is an original football match in Nambore. Mm. So how come you did not kill anybody or tear gas anybody?
Briefly on that, Mr. Musingas, if you have a response.
I thank her for applauding us in the other centers. Mm. That everything was in shape. Mm-hmm. For Umbarara case, I'm going to follow it up with those who are in Umbarara to find out. It was in a hall. Why? And the numbers.
But how come police did not kill anyone? Like you have been doing on opposition rallies. If you were serious on preventing COVID and not using it as a political pandemic.
The judgment is for police, surely. To see whether you have gone beyond the line or you are still within the line. Mm-hmm. We can't judge for them. So if within, because they are the enforcers of the law, within their judgment, they were saying we are still within the line of the law. That is how they held it. Mm-hmm. And we can't force them to do what in their judgment they feel we are still within the law.
Yeah.
So it is an issue that can be followed up.
Good. Mr. Musingas, this election has been a unique one in a way. Mm. It has happened, you know, during a time when Uganda is, you know, facing COVID-19. Mm. Can you share with us some of the challenges that you have faced as electoral commission during this electoral process?
Yeah, true. Enforcing the COVID guidelines themselves. You know, election is a period of excitement. It's a period of excitement. The emotion is running high. And we are telling candidates, please, after nomination, enter your vehicle and go home. We are telling them that when you're going to campaign, come here on TV, go on radio, send SMS messages. But people need to feel the candidate. So enforcing that was a challenge. And when it came to campaigns, still it was the same issue. Mm. And all these issues they are raising came because of this new experience. But we have learned. We have learned. Now we are coming to the end of the polling process. Mm. Next is the pre-polling. We are going to have evaluation of all that happened. How well did we perform? Where we didn't perform? How best can we improve? And the commission will surely invite Madam so that their input is good for the future electoral cycle that is coming.
The Electoral Commission has received a lot of bashing from members of the public, even the president himself. Recently, when he was meeting members of the National Resistance, you know, in a movement, parliamentary caucus. Mm. The members, you know, attributed their loss to the Electoral Commission, and the president came out say those guys have issues. He called you guys corrupt, and she also made a mention of it that you're compromised. Is this a vote of no confidence in the Electoral Commission?
No, it's not. It's not a vote of no confidence. Because you look at the success.
Why should Ugandans trust you with the electoral process?
Look at the success that we have achieved. That is where the judgment should be picked.
Which success?
That we have held successfully the reorganization of polling stations. We have held successfully the demarcation of electoral areas. We have nominated the candidates, by the way, from a village, because we have SIGs which start from a village, up to the national. Now, yesterday we had the youth MPs. We had the other day we had the older persons, PWDs, workers. All those originate from the village and the MPs up. Mm-hmm. We've held presidential elections and parliamentary. The results are out. We've done LOC5, LOC4. There is no election round that has failed. Tomorrow we are going for LOC3. And we shall be done with the election cycle.
Yes,
surely, that one we can't be regarded to have failed. Mm. Yes, we are. There are a few cases here and there because of our staff. We don't recruit from any other place. We recruit from ourselves. The people we deploy come from ourselves. So, and if there are any omissions or commissions at one point or the other, but that one is really at the lower edge compared to where we have reached now.
Sure.
Yes.
Sir, as do you think...
And remember, an election has two sides. We are referees.
I think there are more than two sides.
And a loser.
The stakeholders are more. We are in a multi-party dispensation.
Yes, we fall on the two. That we have this side, those who are contesting, and we have a winner and a loser.
Mm-hmm.
So the two... whoever takes the day, the other one who loses the day must have an argument. But we incorporate all of them. But the bigger picture is we have achieved. Once tomorrow is done, then Ugandans will find.
Of course, you say you have achieved, but of course, there are concerns here and there.
True.
And Sarah, I would want to pick your thoughts on whether you think the Electoral Commission has succeeded in its mandate.
No, generally, this is a sixth election under the 1995 Constitution. The Constitution in Article 1, Article 61, and several other articles provides that Ugandans, especially Article 1, Ugandans shall elect their leaders in regular, free, and fair election. Elections. What the returning officer from WAXO and representative of EC has achieved, together with their predecessors, is regular elections. But they have failed Uganda on free and fair elections, which is a constitutional requirement. The Constitution, or the framers of the Constitution, did not envisage elections as an exercise. Say we have ticked the books. Because what he's celebrating is they have ticked the books. But have you delivered a free and fair election that is mandated by the Constitution? That is a requirement. Because Article 61 is very clear. The Electoral Commission shall is mandatory in law, conduct regular, free and fair elections. Elections under the 1995 Constitution, three of them have been challenged in the Supreme Court. This is the fourth one that has been challenged. And in all the three petitions, the Supreme Court has consistently and overwhelmingly held that elections in this country fall short of what is required in the laws of Uganda. So what are we celebrating? Are you ticking the box? Regular elections, yes. Are they free and fair, as required by the Constitution?
Mr. Msinguzi, Sarah is saying that Electoral Commission has really failed.
They just tick the box.
It's mandate. I want to, you know, try to ask you whether you think, as the electoral body that is responsible for elections in the country, you have, you know, organized, you know, free and fair elections. And if so, why should we, you know, see... candidates, you know, that have lost coming up to, you know, to challenge the elections in courts of laws now four times?
Organize regular, free and fair. Regular.
You tick the box on that. Regular. Yes.
Yes. Those
free and fair has failed.
Free.
With killings? How many people have died in this election?
Because you see,
what is free? This fine free.
Now, the free that we talk about is that a voter or a Ugandan citizen is given all the necessary processes to access a polling station. Is registration free?
This is a fraudulent definition.
I'm coming to that.
Give him time. Yeah.
Okay.
Is registration of voters free? Are Ugandans given the opportunity to access registration centers and express their willingness to participate in an election? Because you see, like she said, that an election is not an event. It's a process.
That's true.
So it starts from then that our Ugandans are given the opportunity to participate freely in all activities. We can't look at only polling day. That because on polling day, there were circumstances beyond and there had to be issues. Let us look at the whole process. Regular, yes, free, our Ugandans are given the opportunity to involve themselves freely in the electoral process that moves up to polling day. Do they participate in the creation of their polling stations? Do they participate in the creation of electoral areas? Do they participate in accessing registration centers during? Are they free to access polling stations on polling day? As Electoral Commission, we have done that. We can bring in other issues. But like I said, we should be able to always draw a line that this is within the mandate of the Electoral Commission. This is as a result of the continuation of the process in Uganda that life has not stopped.
Section 61. Now, Article 61 of the Constitution, its title is Functions of Electoral Commission.
Yes.
And number one, Electoral Commission shall conduct regular, free and fair elections.
Yes.
Does that refer to the AME?
Is the AME part of the Electoral Commission?
That's what I'm asking you. You are saying there are other processes. But the Constitution is clear. It does not say Electoral Commission and other agencies of the state. It says Electoral Commission shall, meaning you don't have room to divert, conduct regular, free and fair elections. And before he goes to define fair, because I'm not writing, let me make a rejoinder on free. Section 3 of the Presidential Elections Act provides that if somebody is intending to contest for presidency in this country, they can consult any time before nominations. Honorable Chagrany and General Tumukunde, I don't know which other candidate applied to inform the Electoral Commission on their intentions to consult. But I know Honorable Chagrany and General Tumukunde wrote to Electoral Commission. Electoral Commission responded, guiding them on how to consult. Did they consult?
We did our part. As Electoral Commission, now you should ask them who stopped them from consulting. That is why we should be interrogating now that those who stopped them from consulting, was there an issue that they were following up? Because as Electoral Commission, if we had denied them the certificate to go and consult, they would say, wait a minute, your work is to do this.
No. I'm just checking with you. Did they consult, yes or no? I'm not asking what happened. Did they consult?
They consulted, because if they managed to give us seconders to their nominations, how did they get them?
Did anybody consult in works?
Consultation is not, they're not supposed to inform my office.
No, they were supposed to.
If they got supporters from Wakiso,
no.
Who seconded them?
Please answer the question. When a candidate is coming to Wakiso, you are the Electoral Commission in Wakiso. If anybody consulted, you would have been the first to know. Because did anybody consult? Are you aware of anybody who consulted?
If they didn't inform
no. You just say yes or no. Are you aware of anybody who consulted?
No one reported it to me.
Exactly, that's what
I wanted.
So meaning
they didn't want to
consult? That's what I wanted.
Yes.
So when you go back to the, what are the parameters of a free election? There should be free citizens' participation, free sharing of ideas, expression of, you know, the candidates share their manifestos, the voters give feedback, and then the voters are able to make an informed choice as to who should lead them. There should be transparency. There should be competitiveness and accountability. Those are the parameters, basic of a free election.
That's right.
How, I would like to know, how would you score these parameters yourself as the cook now in the process? How would you score these five parameters in this election? Or at least in your area where you had jurisdiction?
Yes.
Yeah.
We had all this. We would score ourselves at
100%.
At 100. Because you see, when we talk of transparency, let us look at the Electoral Commission. This is what I was saying. You know what is happening to our argument?
No, no, we are scoring the election.
Yes. Now, when we're going to score the election, like she said, we're a number of stakeholders. Let us look at the individual responsibility of each stakeholder.
Okay.
Let us come to Electoral Commission. Organize free and fair elections in our organization. Where do you accuse us of not being transparent, of not being free, of not being fair? Just as the Electoral Commission. Before we can
free
look at anything else.
Participation of citizens. Citizens have been injured in Ruka, or everywhere where there has been tear gas, including media. You know, the violence extended from opposition leaders and their supporters to media. And you have your colleagues who were wounded, injured. Why you're capturing information to inform the public, freedom of expression. I kept asking Ari Mvure and others, you know what the excuse of COVID as a political weapon? What COVID the guideline did the media violate? I always saw media in the field with their headgear, with their masks, with, you know, because even in this country, to know that elections are violent, the journalists, your colleagues, as they go to the field, they wear as war correspondents. Because in a free election, you should go to the field the way you want. But can you risk?
You
need a vest, you need a headgear. I think that is the best description of the character of elections in this country. Journalists have to wear like war correspondents. So are we at war during elections? Why do they wear like that? Let's assume that everything is okay, like you are scoring yourself. Are these journalists war correspondents? Why do they wear like that?
Yeah, Mr. Gus, take us through that as we conclude on the point of fairness.
You see,
elections.
We are failing to dissect the Electoral Commission mandate and its role. From the roles of other stakeholders attendant in the electoral process. Because if we focus, that's what I've been praying for, if we focused our argument on Electoral Commission, then we would get clearly when I say we have been free, we have been
get
fair.
Get us Article 61 on your phone.
Because you see, you have explained it here, it is very clear.
No.
Because the fairness, because, we should look at the operation of Electoral Commission. When you talk of journalists going to the to cover rallies and what wearing headgear and everything.
War correspondents.
War correspondents. Look, what is the role of Electoral Commission to that? You get it?
Yes.
If the commission has gazetted and said, members, this is how you're going to move. This is the harmonized campaign program. That is our mandate.
When you move,
you do this and this. Please follow this, follow that, follow that. That is our mandate. Now, that does not mean that when we have issued this, that the world has come to stand still. That now there is no any other law that is operational. That you shall move without any traffic guidelines. That you shall move without following any health guidelines. That there are no security guidelines that you should follow. You get it? So that is where we get it wrong. Because someone is in the in the electoral wave, it means other people shouldn't talk about him or her.
Maybe what Sarah is saying that as Electoral Commission, you're responsible because when you nominate a candidate, that candidate becomes your property, right? True, and even these journalists that are following these candidates, you're responsible for them, right? Mm, so when police comes out to beat them, arrest the candidates, the Electoral Commission is expected to come out and protect them. Mm. Tell police that, no, look here, stop doing this, ABC, and, you know. One of the candidates gave us an example of the former EC boss, Rihaja Kasuja, where he was complaining about the involvement of the army in the electoral process.
Exactly.
And he said that if the army does not get out of, you know, the elections, I'm going to get out of it.
Mm.
And he had a meeting with the president and they acted.
Mm.
So what is stopping EC from the
But if the chairperson, Justice Biabakama, did the same, he did put to notice the police. You remember?
He put to notice the police. We didn't see any change.
Mm-hmm. No. Then
it was an action taken within his mandate as the chairperson of the Electoral Commission saying, no, this is what is supposed to happen.
At least he's agreeing with me. That they are the supervisors of elections.
Yes, that one I have not done.
So when elections are disrupted, you are held accountable as a failure.
But also, no, the disruption, we have to look at the origin of the disruption. We can't blanket it.
At least he's agreed.
Because when you blanket it, then you miss the bigger picture. The disruption was a result of what? That is where we should go.
Mm-hmm.
The disruption was a result of what? That is where we should go. We can't blanket it once, but on action taken, the commission has been stunned. On some of the issues,
they have come out. There is no evidence.
They have come out. Because
there is no evidence. Show us evidence.
There is evidence on the
ground. That the commission tried to assert their powers given to them by the
We even have written documentation where the chairperson of the Electoral Commission put to notice the police saying, I'm getting to this. Hmm? And the fact that we are even moving, it shows progress.
Moving progress.
Now, tomorrow, we're having LOC3.
Sure, that's true.
LOC3. Yes.
All right. Before, you know, we go into, you know, the telling bit of it, Sarah, I ask you a question that you have not, you know, really answered. Whether you think on why he has not yet answered. Because you said that the commission has time and again organized a free and fair electoral process. But then we are seeing,
there's no free and fair election in this country.
Candidates challenging
the Supreme Court record is clear.
Courts of law. This is the fourth time. Why are we seeing this?
The Supreme Court record is clear. There is no free and fair election in this country.
Ugandans going to court is their right.
Mm.
And the right to express feeling that you didn't get what you thought you'd get is also proper. Now the commission is waiting to see where it has been faulted.
Okay.
That is when a response will be made. Where have we been faulted as the Electoral Commission?
Mm-hmm.
Then a response will be made.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Musi. You're still watching Urban Today. My name is Henry Sekanja. I have Sarah Biret and tell about Musi Nguzi, who is the Wakiso District Returning Officer. And we are talking about the aftermath of the 2021 elections. Sarah, I want to ask you to talk about tallying. I understand you're one of those that your organization or a coalition of different CSOs that, you know, applied to Electoral Commission. I don't know whether you applied, but you tell us. Where police intercepted you and then, some of your...
The data center.
Yes, data center. Tell us about that. Were you approved to do tallying?
First of all, we are not doing tallying.
Mm.
The data center was for collection of observer information from the field. 7 civil society organizations that we were all accredited in August by the Electoral Commission to do long-term observation of elections, the electoral process. We had one of our colleagues had organized the data center because we were planning to use technology before the digital shutdown, which took away the element of transparency in the election. but the representative of the Electoral Commission think they did perfectly well because for them they had dedicated lines, whereas the transparency mentioned in elections and required is transparency with the citizens who are the major stakeholders of an election, not the technocrats who are conspiring to rig the mandate of the people. So the data center had 26 clerks.
Okay.
These clerks, after the shutdown of internet, we are calling the 2,148 observers we had deployed countrywide. Manual correction of data. But if there was technology still, they would have worked, because we're using codes. People were sending information, observer information, in form of codes. So they would have worked to interpret the codes being sent to the through technology as information being observed in the elections. The police did allege that civil society organizations were tarring elections. This siege happened at 2 p.m. on voting day. Did we have any results? Were there any results anywhere at 2 p.m. on voting day? Did you have any result at 2 p.m. on voting day?
No, no, not yet.
That is a fraudulent allegation, of course, and it's intentional. So there were no results to talk of at 2 p.m. on voting day. Secondly, a total of 2,148 observers countrywide in an election where there are 38 polling stations is not anywhere near required manpower to tally elections. You can, that argument cannot suffice, that I will use 2,000 people to tally elections. You cannot. That is the workshop plus Mukono, half of Mukono. So what elections can you tell? Assuming that the allegation had some water, what elections can you tell? You cannot. We were simply observing elections as accredited by Electoral Commission under its mandate.
Musinguzi, what exactly happened? Did these people inform you about, you know, she has called it, it was a data center where they were collecting data from different observers. But we saw police, you know, sitting in the place and then, you know, taking away their stuff. What exactly happened? Was EC informed about this?
I think that that was police action. I'm sure they have reasons why they moved the way they moved. And, you know, like I said, I'm sure they are following it up either in courts of law with the police. And at an appropriate time, I'm sure police will brief them why they took that that decision.
Okay. And maybe you can share with us the tallying process. What does it involve? Are, you know, Ugandans, beside the EC, are they, you know, encouraged to do a part of tally?
You see, our tallying, actually not, our tallying is the most transparent, the most open, because it starts at the polling station. Leave alone what they bring to the returning office from national to district. Our tally starts at the polling station because the results are announced at the polling station by the presiding officer. And we issue out declaration forms to all candidates agents at the polling stations. So people start adding up. And I'm telling you, when you come to the district study centers, it's only those who have won who turn up to get their declarations from the returning office.
Okay.
So even the results that came to the national, by the time they reached the national, we had already done those announcements at the polling stations. So what we do, the manual and electronic, is to process them to the legal standards, whereby you have a tally sheet, you have a summary of the results, and you have a transmission. That is all we do. But the biggest work is done by presiding officers at polling stations, and they issue out DR forms to all the candidates' agents at the polling station.
Okay.
Then for us, we aggregate them together and give out the final picture.
So are you saying that as a Ugandan, I'm not the Electoral Commission, are you saying that I'm allowed to have my private, you know, tally center, you know, do my tallying, and then I'll say that so-and-so is, you know, performing this way?
People do that, but they are not allowed to announce. The announcing of the election results is a preserve of the Electoral Commission.
Okay.
You can't sit somewhere, you add yourself.
But you can tally, because tally means adding. You can get your declaration forms and add them.
Yes, you see, now,
that's tally.
The additions are made, whether officially in organized places or unofficially, but people add up those results. But the preserve of the announcement, the declaration, is by the Electoral Commission.
Okay.
Now, if any agents of the state moves against any person or persons I'm sure that agency is having information related to their field. Because if it was police, they wouldn't dream and say, let us go and disrupt these people. Maybe they had reasons why they did what they did, surely. And I'm sure at the appropriate time, they'll be briefed. Beautiful. Of what happened.
Sir, there are concerns as civil society that civil society have not done enough, that you only come out during the electoral period. You know, elections are here, that's when you come up, that you have not done enough to engage the citizenry in, you know, voter education and everything. Why is this so?
You know, when you go under the mandate of Uganda Human Rights Commission, the duty to conduct civic education.
Civic education, yeah.
Is for the Uganda Human Rights Commission.
Mm.
There is some duty that falls under Office of Prime Minister overall.
Mm-hmm.
But under Article 38 and the democratic principles in our national objectives and directives of state policy,
mm-hmm.
civil society plays a complementary role to the efforts of government. The challenge with civic education is that we play a complementary role to nothing. And then citizens wrongly abuse us, people who are supposed to play a complementary role, filling the gaps left by government.
That's true.
So we do our job and government does nothing, and then people think it is civil society to blame.
All right. Okay, we're still watching Urban Today. We're going to take a break right now. When we come back, we'll be talking more about voter education. Keep it Urban. We'll be right back.
Urban Today, brought to you by
Metropolitan International University. We offer postgraduate diplomas, bachelor's degree, diploma, certificate programs, weekend, day and evening. Registrations in progress at our campuses.